So our next speaker is Michael Stern, who is a Quest member, and he's actually trying to realize those hybrid systems. So we are looking forward for his lecture.
Okay, good afternoon. I'm going to present you today the activity of the Quantum Nanoelectronics Laboratory at Bar-Ilan University. So, as you can see from the name, as its name suggests, I don't know if it works, we have quantum, so we are related to the Quest Center, and we have nano, so we are related to the nano center of Bar-Ilan. One of our main goals in the Quantum Nanoelectronics Laboratory is to develop an hybrid system and to couple single spins with superconducting circuits. So, since Quantum Nanoelectronics Laboratory at Bar-Ilan University in Quest and in Vienna is a long name, we have a kind of a nickname, which is QNano. And this is a website of the laboratory, which presents our current project. And this is the laboratory. That was the laboratory in 2015. So we made some progress in 2017, almost 1 year ago. We have put some pipes in the lab. Eventually, we installed a dilution fridge. And we are currently trying to make work this fridge and to prepare samples. So our goal, I would say a dream, would be to, we spoke a lot about what kind of things can bring an hybrid system. Our goal, or I would say our dream, would be to connect two systems, microscopic system spins, which can store for a long time information, and superconducting circuits, which can handle it very efficiently. So the idea is, as I said before, a spin is a kind of standalone system, as useful as a standalone telephone if we want to build a computer, but the idea would be to connect these spins by the way of a quantum bus, which would be a superconducting circuit. So if one wants to connect these two systems, one needs to write a kind of Hamiltonian of interaction. And if one put numbers, one finds that the coupling constant between a single spin and a resonator is given by this formula. 4 Hertz times the current fluctuation in nanoampere divided by the distance between the spin and the resonator in micron. So if I put numbers for a typical resonator, for a typical spin, let's say an NV center, and I want to build a resonator at 3 gigahertz, the typical vacuum current fluctuation are of the order of 20 nanoampere. The typical size of distance between a spin and a resonator is of the order of 4 micron. And as a result, the coupling is as small as 20 Hertz. And therefore, it is a reason why it is hard, very hard. So there is a way to cope with this problem, which consists in using a spin ensemble. So by using an amount of N spin, which are coupled to the superconducting resonator, it's possible to enhance the coupling constant from G to square root of N times G. And if I put n spins of the order of 10 to the 12, rather than having 20 hertz, I would have 20 megahertz. 20 megahertz is big in front of both the relaxation rates of the resonator and the decoherence of the NVs, for example. So we can be in the strong coupling regime where the exchange of information between the two systems is much bigger than the rate the information is lost. And in that way, it can be manifested as an anti-crossing between the resonator line and the spin resonance. This is a very nice result from my former group in Saclay. And it's a nice, can it serve as a quantum memory, not always very efficiently, but they are doing some progress now. Yet, it does not solve the problem that I have shown you before. So, if I want really to communicate information between spins, between single spins, I need really to reach the strong coupling regime with a single spin. So, if we look back at the formula, there is, in fact, two parameters which I can change. The distance between the spin and the critical current, the current fluctuation in the resonator. So the first thing that we can do is rather than having a spin at a distance of 4 microns, as I've said before, is to put a spin very close from a constriction and to use state-of-the-art techniques, electron lithography techniques, in order to align it very precisely. So that the coupling, rather than being 20 Hz, can reach, theoretically, 5 kHz. It's good, but not yet enough. If I want to go further, I need to increase as much as possible the second parameter, the current fluctuation. How can I do that? Well, indeed, there is one superconducting circuit which has huge current fluctuation, and this system is a flux qubit. In a flux qubit, you can have current fluctuation of the order of 400 nanoampere, and therefore the coupling constant could reach 100 kilohertz. So if we can have a flux qubit with a coherence time of higher than 10 microseconds, we are done. So I like to introduce you briefly what are flux qubits. So we saw already during the presentation yesterday of a Yale books, a small presentation of a flux qubit. So a flux qubit is a loop, superconducting loop, intersected by 3 or 4 Josephson junctions. It's possible to write the potential energy of a superconducting flux qubit as a sum of the potential energy of each of the junctions. And because we are on a loop, there is a connection between the phase across each junction and the flux threading the loop, which reduces the dimension of the Hamiltonian. And if we solve the Hamiltonian, we find that close to phi 0 over 2, to close to half a flux quantum, the flux qubit is a very nice two-level system. And if we take the energy of the first level minus the energy of the ground state, we get the spectrum of the flux qubit, which is fully determined by two parameters. On one hand, the gap of the flux qubit, which is a tunneling element between the two degenerate states, and the persistent current, which is flowing in the flux qubit. So there is already one problem. As you can see from here, there is a lot, the dependence of the flux qubit as a function of flux is huge, of the order of 1 to 2 gigahertz per millifizero, which means that any flux noise will give rise to decoherence. So in fact, there is only one point where we can work safely without feeling the problem of decoherence, at least at first order. It is exactly at this point where the flux qubit is immune to flux noise. So how can I increase the coherence time of flux qubit? Well, in fact, there has been, in 2011, quite a big revolution in the field of superconducting qubits. The discovery that putting the superconducting qubits here, a transmon, inside of a three-dimensional cavity, helped to increase the coherence time and the relaxation times by almost one order of magnitude. So this is a question we will answer to that. Is it possible to do the same with flux qubit? So flux qubit in 3D cavity. So this is a schematic of the cavity that I used. So it's a cavity, three-dimensional cavity made of copper. It's made of copper in order to apply an external magnetic field, and we measure the cavity by the transmission via the two antennas. In the middle of the cavity, we put a resonator, a lumped element resonator, on a sapphire wafer, and this lumped element resonator is coupled to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 flux qubit. So the advantage of this geometry is that by changing the surface of each qubit, it's possible in a single run to measure several flux qubits. And the reason why we have this LC resonator is because the flux qubit is very small, so in order to have a coupling with the cavity, we need to go through an intermediate resonator. So the first thing we do, we look at the transmission of the cavity, and we find indeed the first and second mode of the cavity, but also this mode, which corresponds to the LC resonator seen via the cavity. This is this mode that we will use in order to detect the qubit. So when we have a qubit in the ground state and we have some coupling, we have a cavity pull or push, depending on whether it is above or below. And this is a way we can detect by sweeping the magnetic field precise and by keeping the probe frequency at the same value and by sweeping the magnetic field. And like that, we detect 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 flux qubits. They appear at different values of the magnetic field because they have different size, different area. So, and to read out the qubit, well, we are in the non-resonant regime, dispersive regime, where delta, the difference between the resonant frequency and the frequency of the qubit is big in front of the coupling. And if we were looking at the transmitted phase via the cavity without any coupling, we would get something like that. But now, if we have a qubit in the ground state, it will push the cavity by chi j squared over delta. Therefore, we get the blue curve. If we have a qubit in the excited state, it will pull it in the opposite direction, and we have the red curve. And therefore, if we measure at a given frequency, we see a change in the phase. So this is a schematic of the way we measure the flux qubit. So we use two tones. The first one, which is to probe the cavity, okay, and we do demodulation of the cavity in order to extract the amplitude and phase, and another tone, where we sweep the frequency until we reach the frequency of the flux qubit. So this is a picture of the RF scheme. You see amplifiers, attenuators, etc., IQ mixers, and this is a typical measurement. So I have chosen not to show you all the six measurements, but to show you only one, which happened to be the best one. So you see, the first thing what we do is we sweep around phi 0 over 2, the flux qubit, and we detect it. We get from that the two parameters of the flux qubit, I mean the gap of the flux qubit and the persistent current. Then we position ourselves exactly at the optimal point, where we can expect to have long coherence time. We look, for example, at the spectra. We see a doublet in the spectra. We look at the T1 by applying a pi pulse. We get a long coherence time, much longer than what was obtained in 2D geometries. And if we do Ramsey seconds, we can extract from this T2 Ramsey of 8 microseconds. There is a beating due to the fact that we have a doublet. And if we want to extend the coherence time, we can do an echo seconds. We get 11 microseconds, which is much smaller than 2T1. We can extract the pure dephasing time of the echo and of the Ramsey by subtracting 1 over 2T2, 2T1. And we see that it's more or less the same. And this indicates us that for this flux qubit, we had a high frequency noise that we attribute to the photon noise in the cavity. So here is a summary of the 6 measured qubits of this run. So what you can see is that the flux qubit is very sensitive to the parameter alpha, which I recall you is the ratio between the small junction to the big junction. You see the control that we have on this alpha for the same design alpha. You see that there can be a jump of almost half a gigahertz in the resonance frequency of the flux qubit, in the gap frequency of the flux qubit. You can see also that the T1 are all quite long, except the T1 for the second qubit and the sixth one, which are per cell limited. Another interesting aspect is that we have very long T2 Ramsey, which can reach up to 8 microseconds. So as a conclusion, we have T1 up to 20 microseconds, T2 up to 8 microseconds. This would be long enough for coupling to single spin. Unfortunately, it is not at the good frequency. So how can we go forward? Well, if I come back to my old formula, 4 hertz delta I0 over R, I would say that one of the possibility, I cannot do more than what I have done before in terms of constriction, but delta I0, maybe I can increase. So delta I0 is directly given by the persistent current of the flux qubit. And the persistent current of the flux qubit, this is a formula which is true for a 3 Josephson junction flux qubit, but anyway, it's not a problem. It's always linear with the critical current of the junctions. So first idea would be, okay, let's increase the critical current of the junctions. So if I do that, okay, this is a picture of the flux qubit that I used in the previous work. Okay, so the size of the junction gives us a critical current of 520 nanoampere. This is the new version. You see that the size of the junction has been increased, and therefore the critical current is increased to 1.5 microampere. Okay, so let's now do exactly the same. We do the spectroscopy. From that we extract the gap and the persistent current, which is high, as I expected to have. But now, if I do a T1 experiment, I look at the T1, I do a pi pulse on the flux qubit, and I get a T1 of 1.5 microseconds, which I would say is quite disappointing. So in order to understand that, we came back to the model of flux qubit. And first of all, we tried to analyze the decoherence of a flux qubit. So the decoherence of a flux qubit, there are several contributions. One is coming from photon noise in the cavity, as I've said before. One is coming from charge dispersion, charge noise. And one is coming from flux noise. Well, I said before that flux qubit is immune to flux noise, but that's true only at first order. So now we take into account the second order of the flux noise, and we get that indeed increasing IP is not so interesting, in fact, because we have second order effects. Above IP of 200 or 300 nanoampere, we are completely limited by this flux noise.
How long time?
2 minutes. That's okay. I compare now the measurement versus theory. So I come back to the qubit with 2.7 gigahertz and IP 245 nanoampere. Here, okay. And if I look at the gamma pure dephasing rate of the echo, I can extract from that the flux noise, which is of the order of 3 microphi zero at 1 hertz. And if I look now at the pure dephasing rate of the Ramsey, I see that there is a quite good fit. It's not a fit, it's just putting a line and extracting the value from here and putting it here. But what I see is that even at phi zero over two, there is a good fit, which means that including second order contribution is important. Well, it explains, just let me 2 minutes. It explains the decoherence, but does not explain relaxation. Well, in fact, I said that there is a flux noise density, which goes like 1/f, it's 1/f noise. So therefore, there is a flux noise density also at 3 gigahertz. And indeed, now I look at the relaxation rate. So there is a relaxation rate coming from quasi-particles, coming from dielectric, coming from Purcell effect. But what I see is that for a flux qubit of persistent current above 300 or 400 nanoampere, the relaxation time is limited, in fact, by the flux noise. And I can verify this by looking once again at the qubit at 2.7 gigahertz and IP 245 nanoampere. I take the value which I extracted from the flux noise from the measurement of decoherence. I get this. I take the value which I extracted from other measurements. I get the quasi-particle losses. And you see that the sum is quite close to what we get, in fact. So, conclusion. First of all, we made some first measurement of a long-lived reproducible flux qubit in 3D cavity. T1, 20 microseconds, T2 of the order of 8 microseconds, but at quite high frequencies. If you increase the current, you don't gain. And I will finish with a well-known sentence of Jean de La Fontaine. There is no point, the hare and the tortoise. There is no point run, must live on time, which I will slightly modify, must live for a long time. Thank you.